Good morning, everybody, to the sessions of the Young Ophthalmologist Society of India. So the first session is Stand Out or Lose Out, Improving Your Presentation Skills. I invite Dr. Sabyasachi Sen Gupta to the chair, and also the president of Young Ophthalmology Society of India, Dr. Digvijay Singh, to please chair the session.
Hello, everyone. A very good afternoon to all of you. And so we'll get right underway. The first talk is going to be by Dr. Karan Bhatia. He's an associate consultant at Center for Sight in Delhi. And he's also the joint secretary of the Young Ophthalmology Society of India. And Karan, you can go ahead with your talk.
So hello, everybody. I'll start off with a video. So my topic is designing effective PowerPoint or keynote presentations. The reason I had shown this video is because presentations are such like a magic trick. So it's like the way you present it, the way you show those tricks, that's how your audience will get impressed and will take the message home. So I always use the 8-second rule. That is, you have the first 8 seconds to impress the audience. Otherwise they'll fall asleep, they'll go off somewhere, and they'll be texting and using their phones. So this 8 seconds is very critical. So basically, this is what you don't want. So I was searching through the net, and what I found was this interesting photo there. So if you look over here, this person over here, he's being sentenced to death. And it's not by a guillotine, it's not by, you know, hanging or electrocution. He's actually being subjected to death by PowerPoint. So what we need is actually a supercharged presentation. So you need a diva in the center, you want all those show tricks, you want everything all out there. So first of all, you need to know what your target audience is, okay? So as this slide is over here, so this is a theme, this is pictures from the movie Avengers. So you've got Thanos over here with the Infinity Gauntlet, and you've got the Avengers over here trying to, you know, defeat him. But if I'm speaking at a session where people don't understand what this is, they're not going to understand and get the message. So let's go to the presentation as such. The first one is choosing the right background. So over here, if you look, there's one with the light text on a dark background. The second one is a dark text on a light background. The third one is a dark text on a dark background, and the last one is light text on a light background. So I'm pretty much sure everyone cannot read over here the last two ones over here. So you have to actually concentrate on this one or this one. So basically, we want high contrast between the text and the background colors. Now coming to the fonts. So we have various fonts available. We have the Helvetica, which is very nice, and you can see, you can read properly. We've got the Stratello, which is, you can't read this font. The most common font that is used in all presentations is the Times New Roman font. Now make sure the font that you use, whatever you use, it should be easily readable by the audience. It should not be complicated, it should not be scribble. So you don't want the audience to make an effort while reading it. Second of all, then coming to the font size. Now there's a big presentation hall over here. It should be readable by everybody. It should not be in a position too small so that the people at the back are struggling to read it. As a general rule, you can keep 2 meters distance from the screen of your computer. If you're able to read it, the audience should be able to read it. Now, using more than 3 fonts actually violates the consistency. So if you see the different fonts, again, the audience get confused over here with what is happening. Now, coming to a little bit of pictures. Now, over here, if you see, there's a picture over here. There's a lot of matter over here. So this is one of my old presentations. and you take a look. Now the audience, you guys are all confused. What am I supposed to concentrate over here? Am I supposed to look at the picture or am I supposed to look at the text and restart reading? And you've got so much text over here that the audience will start reading and not pay attention to what you're actually saying. So another mistake over here is all of them are in capital letters. So capital letters makes reading difficult, so you don't want it. Look at this slide, I got it from the net again. It's so difficult, what is going on over here? You're not reading, you're not here for a textbook, to read a textbook, you're here to make that learning a little bit easy. So don't put too much information on your slides, less is more. So I always apply a 6x6 rule which says that 6 points per slide and 6 words in each point. Now, we come to the next. Now if you look at this over here, again too much matter over here. You don't want the person to concentrate on this. This is not required. What you just show this picture that you're going to mark two positions over here on the of the alignment for the toric aisle, the marking, and that should be enough. You can show the marking video, you can show how marking is done, but you don't need to mention all these points. Coming to the text part. Now you are confused as to what am I supposed to look over here? Am I supposed to be looking at this or am I supposed to be looking at this picture? Now if you want to highlight something, you can use the reverse text. Now though I have used a lesser font over here, this becomes more prominent and red always stands out. So this is a way you can bring out your presentations. Next thing is flowcharts are good. So as this flowchart, I'll explain it. In recent years, phacoemulsification has changed the fundamental aim of cataract surgery. Earlier, it was the replacement of a cataractous lens with an IOL. Nowadays, it is the patient wants the UCVA to become the BCVA. So if you use the flowchart over here, the audience can easily understand what is going through in your mind. If you look at this presentation over here, now I want to stress on the point that the cell membrane of Pythium organism does not have ergosterol. So you can use these circle rings over here to highlight your point, and so that the person or your audience is just concentrating on this circle rather than the entire matter that is there. Clinical picture, you can start describing the photographs. If there's a lot of time problem is there, so you can always say that there's a varied presentation and you can just skip through a lot of matter. Or you can describe your presentations like this I have done over here. This is a case of Pythium again. So I'm describing, you can see there are arrow marks over here to show what I'm trying to show over here. And again, there are references. If you've taken a picture from a journal or something, if you've taken matter from your journal, it's very important that you give your references. Avoid spelling and grammatical errors. These are a big, big problem and this is a big no-no. So basically, always proofread your answers. Again, pictorial presentations are much better than, you know, what you're writing on the screen. So if you see, I'm trying to show that femtorexis is more round in comparison to a manual. But this photograph or these pictures are showing whatever I want to show. I don't need to speak much about it then. This is one of my older presentations as well. Now, this is about intraoperative alignment of a toric aisle. Now, I don't expect you to read what is going on here. So instead of doing that, what I should be doing is, I should be showing you a video that I have already put the aisle inside. Now I'm going to do the AC wash in front of the aisle and behind the aisle, and after that is then done, I will then rotate the aisle into the proper position that I want it to be. So basically, visual media is more eye-catching than textual media. If you look at these, now coming to tables and graphs, you can highlight these points that you actually want to show. So you can use these highlighters or you can use red marks. And then what you want, the audience is not going to understand the table. So you can just point out what you want them to read. That's it. That's their take-home message. Now, slides have the keynote has a very good feature of instant alpha for picture editing, where you can remove this blue background and make it look like this. So it becomes part of the presentation. Again, use a lot of animations. I use a lot of animations in my presentations. And I'm a big Game of Thrones fan, so I try to use as much as possible. Sorry, this video is not working. Yeah. So then again, engage the audience and always stick to your time. It's always too much work. You're always stressed out. But again, the importance is success. You have to become successful. You need to give time. Thank you so much.
I think that was quite well put, and that I think are the main points in PowerPoints. As it is, show and tell. That is more important, rather than make people read and learn. So that's quite well done.
Thank you.
We can next have Srinivas is here. We're going to now learn more on the videos front. How do we go about creating world-class videos? And I think videos are a very important part of not just video presentations themselves, but also as you know, as part of PowerPoints or as part of standalone learning material. So
BGN,
that's what we're doing. Yes.
Keynote presentations are definitely much, much better. See, the concept of Apple is it's customized. So everything, if you follow a specific trend which everybody has, see, a presentation is a way in which you differentiate yourself from the others. You have to stand out from the crowd. So the more customized you make it, it's much better. Apple has got much better features. And I used to earlier use PowerPoint. Now I've completely shifted to Keynote, and I convert the presentations to PowerPoint and then use them. Once you start using the Keynote, you'll understand there are other platforms as well, but Keynote is definitely better than PowerPoint.
Hello. Yeah. So I've been using Keynote for last 1.5 years now, and my problem is that most of the AV consoles they ask us to convert it into a PowerPoint presentation. Now, when I convert the presentation, Keynote presentation, into a PowerPoint presentation, everything gets haywire. Whether it's the flowchart or there are photographs over there. Supposing I have highlighted something in my Keynote presentation, everything I have to sort everything back in the PowerPoint, another effort that we have to make.
That is always there. That is why you must have seen, I asked them, I'm going to put my own laptop.
Yes,
but a lot of conferences do not allow
that.
Allow you, so then you have to convert to PowerPoint if you're using Keynote, otherwise you make your presentations on a PowerPoint.
Even if you're using the PowerPoint, you have made it some other font, some other style, and you're saving it in some other format. It usually change a lot.
That is
especially this is the basically word problem.
That is why you stick to the fonts that is there. You stick to Times New Roman. That font is available everywhere.
Okay.
Even the older versions, sometimes the conferences, what they have is the older version of PowerPoints. So your fonts get displaced, your graphs get displaced. So even in the graphs and whatever you're using, keep Times New Roman.
Okay.
That is available everywhere.
The other thing is most conferences also mention, you know, that you can have slides as a 16:9 or a 4:3 if you go through the instructions, because a lot of the times the projecting screens, for example, this is a 4:3, but they do allow 16:9 on this. So either you will either end up getting stretched images or you'll get a smaller screen. So when you make that change, that also when things go haywire. So just look at that from that front. Ideally, people are moving now more towards 16:9. Widescreen is the new kind of thing in most bigger halls. But the smaller halls, that remains a bit of an issue sometimes.
I think that's where the concept of preview room is now being given.
Yes.
Yeah, thank you.
See, if you're using your own laptop, you can use Helvetica, but if I would still suggest, the fonts can always be a problem if you're uploading it onto somebody else's computer. So use Times New Roman. Actually, there's a lot of people recommend there's another font called Sans Serif. That's visually very good as well, but the problem again is like I was making on a Keynote. It did not have Sans Serif. That's why I couldn't show it there. So again, Times New Roman is a font that is available everywhere. Stick to universal platforms.
Okay.
Sir, I just, day before yesterday, I was making a presentation. The flow charts, the flow charts and the charts, that bar charts that you make in Keynote, they completely get changed. If it's a round chart, if it's a bar chart, PowerPoint presentation mein it gets all haywire. The round curves converted.
Itna jada change nahi hota. Ek kaam karte hain. You meet me after this session is over. I'll tell you what I know, and then you can teach me a lot as well.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Check karo. Okay. Ready?
So the next speaker is Dr. Srinivas M. Joshi. He belongs to M.M. Joshi AI Hospital, Hubli, Karnataka. He's a retinal surgeon there. He's a very dynamic young surgeon who's presented world-class videos and won awards at international platforms as well. So I welcome you, sir, to give this wonderful talk.
Thank you, Karan. First of all, I would like to thank all the Yo team consisting of Divakant, Karan, Apurva, and all the Yo members. You are doing a fantastic job. Keep it up, and looking forward for more from you all. And thanks for giving an opportunity. I don't know why you have selected me as a person for giving a world-class video, but I will try to see what best I can do in this. And congratulations, Yo team, for your success in this conference. So I have no financial disclosures in any other products. Can you just shift the timer towards me so that I can see the timer discussed in this presentation? We all know a picture says 1,000 words can, and a video says, I think you know it much better. So in presenting a concept or a surgical technique, videos are very important. And a great teaching, it's a self-learning tool. Everybody makes videos, but how you need to make videos so that you stand out of it, so that it's one of the best videos is what is important. There are two steps of it. One is during the surgery, and one is post-surgery, right? So during the surgery, what all we need to do it? Please look in for centration, focus, brightness, and lightening. Centration, focus, and brightness. Centration, focus, and brightness. These are the tip, very basic three mantras you need to know while you're recording your videos. See, I will show some videos here, okay? See, a surgeon is operating here, and the screen is at his back, right? So what you need to do, see, you cannot have an ideal OT setup everywhere. So in some case, see here, the middle person comes in and tells, sir, your video is not centered. See, that is what is important. So when you have it in front, then make it a habit that you are always centered, you are always focused. See, the field of view, what you see in the microscope is much bigger than what you record through the cameras. So always you look in for the centration. You see there? The assistant comes in and tells, then the surgeon looks back, then he says, okay, I will readjust it, I will recenter it. So whenever you are having a screen at the back or beside you, if you are not able to see it, then have a good assistant who will tell you, sir, it's going blurred. Because you will be very immersed in your surgical techniques. You find it difficult, there is a complication. Complication is where you need to record it. Simple surgeries, everybody does it, everybody records it. But what you need to record is complication. So whenever it's complication, we do not give much idea to look more into the focusing. But just a simple technique, wait, understand what your technician is telling. Center it, you will enjoy doing and surgeries. And if there is any complication, you will learn how to make it much better the next time. The next one is the focus. See, there are two things in the focus. Of course, the focus has to be there. See, what happens in a young surgeons like you all, many of them try to accommodate. So you usually do not see at the screen, but you say, sir, I want to get this SICS done. I want it neatly. I do not bother about what is happening in the TV. So always need to look into the TV, whether it is centered. See here, you see, I'll just play this video again. And most important is the magnification. You have to concentrate on the magnification. See here, a surgeon is doing the Rexus. It's going out. Of course, he brings it back again. Now you see in the next step, how you see so nicely you see in the magnified view, isn't it? So in the magnification, you really will know whether it is focused or not focused. And please remember the point, sometimes you magnify so much that it gets out of the screen. So you have to magnify in a way where it fits into the screen, right? So the focus, centration, magnification, these are the very important tips. The area of interest is another important point. What is area of interest? See, whenever you are doing a phacoemulsification or any retinal surgery, you try to focus it so much, you try to zoom it so much, that you actually lose the area of interest. So where you want to record it, like you are doing a chop, then your area of interest has to be towards your phaco tip and the nucleus part which you are chopping. So the area of interest, what you do is very important, right? And then comes here is the, of course, the 3D surgery. Here, if you have an accessibility to the 3D surgery, I think it will be of much importance is because in the 3D surgery, you see everything. So whatever you see, you do. If it looks blur, you see it in front of the TV. See here, I wear the 3D glass. One of my assistant wear the 3D glass, my fellow, so that you will have a good focusing. Depth is good. Magnification is good. View of field is good. The peripheral field of view is good. So in these cases, if you have a 3D accessibility, is well and good. What are the stuff we require while you want to have a video recording? The most important is the microscope, the beam splitter, the C mount, and of course, the preferred original adapters. I'll tell you about the adapters later. Traditionally, what we use is the camera, that is the charged coupled devices. That is a CCD, that is a medical grade cameras. You have a C mount, sensor size has to match with the adapter, And whether it's a single chip, three chip, these all play in lakhs together. Of course, you can have a Jugaad. You can have your own Panasonic, your own Sony, your own Nikon, whatever it is, you can have it. The most important things here you need to remember is the adapter and the beam splitter. So always ask for the beam splitter from the company itself. Like we are having a Leica microscope, ask them to have their own beam splitters. Of course, many companies do provide it. But the importance here is the adapter. See, what we usually don't understand is the focal length of the adapter, this one, should match the focal length of the camera size. The sensor size of these both have to match with each other. Sometimes we try to fix it where the focal length doesn't match, it causes a vignette. That means you see a peripheral dark area, but centrally you're able to see, well, what is happening? Some microscope ka button in beech mein aa gaya kya? That we keep learning. So always remember that the focal length of the camera as well as the focal length of the adapter has to match. The adapters, if you go in for the world class, it's expensive. If you go in for Indian made, they are cheaper, but you need to look into which suits your best. And of course, if you have a Sony, then you need a T2 adapter, but if you don't have it, you don't need it, because adapter does most of the work for you. What is this point is very, very important. You always have a good camera, don't you? You always have a good mobile. You always try to take a good camera. You always have a good microscope, don't you? Yes, but what is important which matters, which most of us don't understand, actually are the quality of the glass which is used in the adapters. That is what matters the most. The quality in the glass is what plays the significant amount of difference in your videos. So there are various video editing softwares like DaVinci, Final Pro Cut, I'll not go into the more. Whichever, I use Wondershare Filmora, which is very easier for me. Of course, you can use any video editing software, which is good. So keep the video short and concise. The audience have a very small span of attention. Don't show them big videos like 7-8 minutes. If you have it, use good graphics. Don't neglect the audio quality. Always use the good headphones when you're recording, and keep try to record in a silent and the quiet room. So whenever you are editing it, try to have the best resolution possible. See, there is a lot of difference when you do it in a smaller resolution to higher resolution. Whether you want to do it in a HD or whether you want it in a 4K. 4K has a lot space. But let me tell you, my dear young friends, always record in the best video quality possible. The only thing which might go is the hard disk size. You might have to have one hard disk, second hard disk, third hard disk, fourth, but it is worth, I'll tell you. Right? You might have to spend a little bit, but if you are quick enough, if you are very punctual, you can edit the videos in within a week or within a day. But if your habit is not punctual like me, then ideally have a big TBs. Why I'm telling you? You tend to edit it multiple times. If you edit it in a lower software size, lower resolution, then you will lose the quality or the resolution. If you do it in a 4K or in a full HD format, it takes more space, but tell you, it is worth winning the videos. So I'll not go into the more detail. Let me tell you about a little bit of the graphics. Can I have the audio, please? See, whenever you use the videos, try to have the graphics which makes sense. So this is the optic disc pit. The pit is trying to get in through. So here I'm using the graphic where the boat, Titanic boat, where it hit, the fluid is trying to come inside the boat. So try to use the graphics which match your sequence, right? So here I'm trying to do an optic disc pit maculopathy. This figure, this picture, I'm staining it. I'm trying to do an ILM peeling and try to stuff inside the macular hole. So whenever you have a good quality audio, and of course the graphics which you use. See, now what I'm doing, I'm trying to plug these optic disc pit, right? So next, what should be my graphic? That it is sealed. So try to use the graphics which are suiting your sequences, the theme of your video. See, once I do that, here I'll show you. You see this? See, now all the watertight compartments are being blocked. So whenever you do an graphics editing, try to use it which matches your sequences. See here, watertight door indicator. So my retina is tight. It is without fluid. Something like that. And most importantly, drape on, drape off. Record your video once you drape on, and stop your video once you drape off. You do not expect complications. But complications happen. So the most important thing is how you handle that complication is more important. Then we try looking for, oh, card khatam ho gaya sir, main idhar kuch space create karta hoon. No. Try to have a a good space in you to drape on, to drape off, you have to record it. Don't speed up the videos unnecessarily by speeding up. It really spoils it. What you need to do is have a good editing. You need to sit in a quiet room while you're editing. Don't do editing while in your OPD or anything. Go home, relax. When you have food, that's the best time. Or when you get up in the morning, that's the best time you need. You need a lot of concentration when you do editing. Add a personalized touch. And of course, these are all there. Just 30 seconds more. And take home message here is a convincing and a concise. So we'll keep serving the purpose is have patience, have a good video software, have a good adapters. That is what makes the mantra for this. So these are, I think that is why Apurva and Karan have selected me for this. Is just we won the two ASRS Red Bucklers and Dr. Guru Prasad won it. So from past 3 years, we have won the three ASRS Red Bucklers Oscar Awards. And that's it. Any questions? I'll be able to answer it here or outside till the knowledge I have.
That was a wonderful presentation, Dr. Srinivas. I think with the kind of tips you've given, those awards are obviously always well deserved, and I hope you continue to win them again.
Thank you.
Any questions from the audience?
One question at least, so I'll be happy. Yeah? No?
We'll take the questions later then.
Sure, thank you.
So, I'll call the next speaker onto the dais, Dr. Digvijay Singh, who is the director of the Noble Eye Care Center in Gurgaon. He's a senior consultant in HOD of Narayana Super Speciality Hospital, Gurgaon. He's been trained at AIIMS RP Center for 12 years and is also the president of the Young Ophthalmologist Society of India. His talk is on the art of public speaking and engaging the audience. So we also have here with us Dr. Harsha Bhattacharya ji, sir, who is the founder chairman of Sri Shankara Deva Netralaya Guwahati. Welcome, sir. And I'd also like to invite right now on the dais Dr. Ronald Soibam, who is a VR consultant SSN Guwahati, onto the dais, please. Sir, please come.
I think it is indeed heartwarming to see that the Young Ophthalmic Society of India has reached a stage where we're able to have our own sessions like this in our own place, and support from all the senior mentors we've had is great, and I'm sure that, and I'm hope that you continue to do that, and all of us continue to be part of this thing. Thanks, Karan. So I'll now be moving on to this art of speaking well, public speaking, or speaking well in public, or at presentations, or at conferences like this, something that everybody will and should have to do, and I think that is a very important thing. You have to stand out, as is the name of the session, otherwise you'll be just one among so many. So let's look at the first thing, the tips that we look at, and this is kind of the situation that is often there, and the hall's full as well now, so I'm glad this photo matches up there. So the first step, the first thing is that you should know the audience that you're speaking to. That's very important, because I have seen certain colleagues who have been presenting a similar presentation, to the postgraduates, to the specialists, to small close groups, but that doesn't work like that, because you need to know what your audience's level of knowledge already is, and you need to kind of step up and move on to that. So if you're not aware of that, then you'll probably not be doing justice to your time and to their time at all. So know what the audience speaks. Try and get from the audience, if you can gauge, what do they want to know about it. So there are a lot of times we have limited time to speak, and we can specifically ask the audience, this is what we are going to summarize, if there's anything in specific that requires, you can then spend a little more time on that. But that's the very first thing, because we really don't want a bored audience sitting around like that, because you've been telling them something that they already knew, or something that was so well beyond them that even though you're trying to explain it to them in your way, they're just not at the same wavelength or at the same level. I think we had a good presentation by Karan on the slide. So you don't want over busy slides. This one, which is this blue slide here. Do we have a pointer? Okay, yeah, it's there. So that's another thing. This is an important tool to have. So we don't want a slide which is so busy, because people will just kind of keep on reading. This is an ideal slide. Few points, maybe a pictorial graph and a title. The title should be able to summarize the whole thing. So if somebody looks at the title and the picture alone, they should be able to get a good idea of what's there, what's in on that slide. Because we don't want to overload people with knowledge. Remember, we don't have to tell them everything. You have to tell them something. So you're not there to teach them the entire subject. That's not possible. even in the longest of presentations, that's not possible. And even and in the shortest of presentations, if you tell them the important take-home messages or the important somethings, then even a few-minute presentation does the a good job at that. So you need to tell them something, but definitely not everything, and that's important. We don't want an overload of knowledge that is there. The other important thing is that you need to really know the material very well. So you need to know what you're going to talk about. So it's important to read up about it beyond what just you're presenting. You should be ideally an expert in that subject by the time you're on the stage, because one, you could have questions which you need to answer. But more than that, if you know your material well, if you know your content well, and you also know what's there on what slides, then you're going to be very confident. And even if, let's say, the PowerPoint doesn't work or something goes wrong with that, you still should be able to then say the whole thing to the audience without really needing the, you know, without really having that. And that is when you'll feel that, yes, I'm quite confident. I know all the material that I have with me pretty well. So that's the important part on that front. Before I move on to this, I'll come to this point, which is a very important point. So knowing all the content is very important, because also you need to time it well. So you must rehearse. And to because we need to end it within the time that is allotted. So one of the ways of rehearsing is has traditionally been looking at the mirror and rehearsing, because one, that gives you more confidence. It also helps you know, settle your jitteriness. And so that's an important way of doing it, and doing it aloud. So one is that, you know, in your mind you're reading your content, but it helps to say it aloud and say it in the mirror, because you yourself are your best critic in that sense. The mirror is your sounding board, but you can use a colleague, you can use a friend, you can use a casual of a few juniors, a senior if they're willing to spend time with you, but that's a very important thing. And try and end it slightly before time if possible, you know, because you don't know that when you're speaking, something may interrupt the process, somebody may ask something in between, there may be a discussion, so just keep a little bit of time therein. The other thing is, what is the speed at which you should speak? So we don't want to speak so quickly that nobody can understand us, but at the same time, we don't want to speak so slowly that it'll take forever to get through the content, because people lose interest. And the other thing is that a lot of times, everybody would not have the same language skills as we do. You know, we're often good at English in India, but if you're doing an international conference, there'd be many people who would not understand it well at all, and would actually require you to literally spell out things to tell them. And I've been to conferences in Tokyo, and I've been to conferences in China, and there are a lot of conferences where actually you have, you know, translators translating it for you through a system. But in most such conferences, if you speak slowly, it gives time for people to understand and also digest whatever material you've essentially given them. The other thing is, make good eye contact. So this is important, because not only when you're making good eye contact, are you actually being convinced or convincing the other person with regard to your content, but they're more likely to retain it, and they're more likely to be paying attention to you if you're paying attention to them. You really don't want to be doing this, that looking into the screen all the time, or you know, fiddling with your hair or doing something else. It's important to maintain eye contact, and that's how we normally would, you know, speak to anybody at all. You need to add humor. So we want the audience to be laughing, but we don't want them to be hilariously laughing. But you don't want to get too much emotion. So we don't want to be like a Hillary Clinton. It helps in their field, but not so much in our field. So that's the other important. It's not helped us in our field either. So yes, that is actually a very valid point. So that is a very important thing that we were looking at. And of course, interaction. So you know, so you could actually be, there are a lot of places, if you can get a cordless mic, it's quite ideal if you have to walk around, and I've taken certain sessions like that, but that's not usually the case. But interaction could be in the form of certain questions in between, but sometimes not everybody appreciates that either. So you need to judge the audience, you need to judge how responsive they are. But you could interact in the form of a raise of hands once in a while, in case you're finding that they're losing the interest. So it does help to interact. And eye contact alone is a good form of interaction, by the way. Thank the audience. So as we are going to now thank you very soon, but it's important that you thank the audience. You don't have to be over thankful either. You don't have to be under thankful, but you should have a small thank you thing on the note on the slide. So something like this goes a long way, because they have, after all, given you time and to hear you and to listen to you. So I do thank all of you for, you know, giving your time here and listening to this. And if there are any questions, you know.
Excellent talk, sir. I think those are very good pointers that you had laid out. And I think one of the most important points is that, you know, you should engage the audience and look at the audience as well. Sir, any comments you'd like to make? We have Dr. Anand Pasari, who is a cornea refractive and cataract consultant at Nagpur. He's been trained at PGI Chandigarh as well and has won a lot of international awards, including Best Poster Awards. So he'll be talking about the constructing award-winning poster.
Thank you, Karan, for that warm introduction. So I'll be discussing how to construct an award-winning poster. So. First of all, after hearing interesting talks on how to make an award-winning paper and award-winning video, why a poster? Often we feel that a poster is a bit of bland kind of a thing, but when we send a poster for abstract for a poster submission, there are very high chances of acceptance. So it's a very good opportunity for beginners. So I begin my first presentation as a poster at a GSI conference in 2013 as a second year resident. So for people who are just beginning in the to send presentations, for it's a very good idea to send it as a free paper or a poster presentation, because high likelihood of being accepted as a poster presentation. So our poster often stands out as a conversation starter for new projects and ideas with people who often come to view our poster at the presentations. And it also reaches large number of delegates who are often not associated to our fields. Our poster often is kept hanging in our departments for years together. And then again, everybody cannot be a very good speaker. So scientific posters, especially in the conferences like American Academy of Ophthalmology, are given a huge importance and designated a large area. Again, there is a very designated area of poster presentation, and a board is provided, a special panel is provided where you can mount a poster. So now we have the physical posters or the e-posters, or now even the poster podium presentations. So what is a poster? It's just an illustrated abstract. So the abstract, which is the summary of our research work, just goes into a visual summary, which we call a poster. So purpose of a poster is to not to communicate every little detail of our fantastic research, but to give a concise and a visual summary of our research so as to attract people's attention to our research work. So, and a poster is just not a bottomless pit where you dump all your technical data and lingo. So how to make a good poster? The first step is to prepare a good script. So before you consider opening a PowerPoint for making slides for the poster, first it's good to begin our script in the Microsoft Word and track down our number of words. This gives us the word count and also checks us our spelling. So less words is very important, and they say the word should be as less as 250, but it might not be possible every time. So we also need to be very important while designing the poster to see who is the target audience. We should ask ourselves, who is my ideal audience for the poster? Is it the other experts from our field, or perhaps the broader public? And what is their level of understanding of the subjects? So this would help us to prepare the script for our poster. So the poster should have shouldn't have any paragraphs. Rather, we should have small sentences with bullet points. A poster should not look like a paper. Therefore, bullet points are very important. So we should use sections with headers, which include the background or the preface, which gives an introduction to why exactly this study was planned. So, and then comes the purpose of the study, which is the question of our study. Then the materials and methods, which should be kept as small as possible. Then results and conclusions, and at the last, references and acknowledgments, which should become in smaller fonts at the bottom. So it's important to cut down the text, because packaging too much of the information makes it difficult to understand. So thus, when it comes to posters, less is the best. So coming to the data which we include in the poster, it's important to include files, the visual graphs as JPG images, as PNG images rather than JPG images, because the images get blurred. Then comes to this concept, which is the step two, which we grab a paper and then put up a brief a design using a pen and a paper, and then which we decide the layout and the size, layout and size of the poster. So whether it has to be a vertical or a horizontal depends on what are the guidelines which has been provided by the scientific committee or the organizers of the conference. So you do not want to show up at the conference with a poster which were made up a vertical, rather which was expected to be a horizontal poster. And it's important to leave spaces at the edges. So the organization, the best would be to start with the left-hand side upper corner and then go on towards the right-hand side lower corner. So while designing the poster, it's important to have negative spaces. Many feel the need to cover every inch of the poster with images or text. This is a very wrong idea, as it makes it difficult for the viewer to find the relevant information. So clear spaces, as much as 30 to 40% makes our poster makes our poster easier to understand and get a brief idea about our poster. So it's very important to let our poster breathe. As we can see this in this poster, there are a lot of clear areas, and we can grab the brief points like introduction, results, discussion, and conclusions. So, and then when we are designing a poster, we do not want the poster to look like this multiple colors, because you don't want to burn your retina. So we need to have very appropriate colors. And then backgrounds are not expected. Like as we see a background in this mix, it's difficult to see the bird. So, and then it's important to go with appropriate fonts. So for the body, it's good to have Times New Roman font, and for the title, it's good to have the Arial font. So here, like we see on the left-hand side, the fonts are readily visible and understanding. Well, on the left side, on the right side, it's these are difficult to understand. So does the size of the font matters? Yes, very important. How large should you make the type, the font size? So it should be as large as possible. So the thumb rule is the smallest text from the poster should be able to be read from 6 to 10 feet away. So a 72 points font size for the titles, 48 points for headings, 24 points for the body text, and then 18 points for the caption is good. Remember, these are the minimum values, and bigger is always welcome. So look in the poster here. It's a very kind of a disorganized poster, and the person who visits to see this kind of poster feels, where do I start from? And then you have another poster where the text in the main body is pretty small. So let's see some of the good and the bad posters. So you have a poster like this, you really don't know where should we begin. And then when we have a poster like this, it definitely makes the person feel sleepy when somebody visits this kind of a poster. And again, then this poster again doesn't have a proper organization, a proper flow, so it might the reader may not be able to comprehend what's going on. And then you have a poster with a kind of a dark colored background like this, which makes the actual content of the poster, reading the poster, very difficult. And again, this kind of a poster where there is no proper contrast and very small fonts and full of text in the poster, which makes reading this poster difficult. And this is what we call a nice poster. It has a good breathing space, it has good contrast and good proper fonts, and there is it has a proper flow of the structures. So such a well-designed poster will stand out all other posters. And in the nutshell, the poster should grab our eyeballs to make it award-winning one. So in brief, we need appropriate script, then appropriate design, and then then include the data so that we can make good posters. Thank you for your kind attention.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah, thanks Dr. Anand for that. I think posters are actually a very, very important part of conferences. And so there's a lot of things that we can't accommodate and we don't necessarily require to speak about. And that's where posters come in. And as young ophthalmologists, we should really know how to design posters well. So that was actually quite well put, and that's a lot of good tips for all of us. Thanks for that talk.
Next we have Dr. Sabyasachi Sengupta, who has been trained from a lot of premier institutes of the country, including Jipmer, Arvind Eye Hospital, Pondicherry, Shankar Netralaya, Chennai. He's also received a fellowship in research from Wilmer Institute, USA. He's presently a VR surgeon at Mumbai and the associate editor of IJO. He's also received the McCartney Prize from FRCO, and this is the first non-British national to get this award. Now his talk is the perfect way of presenting your answers in postgraduate ophthalmology exams. And the reason we've given him this talk is because he is a DNB gold medalist. Now that is not everybody's cup of tea. So welcome, sir.
Thanks, Karan, for that introduction. So today first of all, I would like to thank all the speakers for sticking to their time so I have some breathing space and we can discuss a few things. So what we are really going to talk about, is not really presenting or designing posters, because we've already been through that. But as you will notice, the script is quite similar, because what you do with your presentations and your posters is almost similar to what you will do when you're writing an exam. So what we will really talk about is how do you write, your answer paper. So, it's always good for you to start your presentations by giving people an outline of how you're going to speak, and then actually keep repeating the slide so that, it's driven into people's minds. So what you really need to do when you see, when you're preparing or when you're thinking about writing your exams is, of course, you need to prepare well for that exam, read and understand the question well, plan your answer, execute your answer. Of course, handwritings and illustrations are a very key aspect. We'll look at a little bit of that. And of course, time management. So, you really need to keep looking at your watch every now and then. So we'll talk a little bit about each of these headings. So, before going, as you've seen, while making a video, you need to record the video well to actually make a good video out of it. So of course, for writing a good answer, you really need to prepare well. So you can refer to previous, short questions and write important questions topic-wise. So what are the important questions expected in retina or in cornea or in glaucoma or in general ophthalmology? Use question banks. There are many, many different question banks. DNB website itself has a question bank. eoptha.com is a very nice website. It's designed by an Indian. And it's pretty much the best there is for residents in India. Look at eoptha, you will get a lot of question bank there. Plan for attempting the questions even when you're preparing. Think about important key points, flow diagrams, illustrations, etc. Maybe maintain a diary of how you are really, you've read a very large chapter, say from one of the major textbooks, and you really need to make a concise and a very precise sort of presentation and put it down on paper. So how will you really do that? It's not very easy. You really need to think about it even when you're preparing. Discuss with your colleagues, you may have good exchange of ideas and learn to write a particular answer better. And remember that all of these is very really applicable only when you're preparing just prior to your exams. So caveat here is hard work throughout the residency. Read the best books. Don't really take shortcuts. You're really going to write an answer only when you are appearing for an exam. But you really need to read the best books. Only when you have a lot of knowledge will you be able to put it all down on paper in a very precise way. The second thing that you should think about when you're actually looking at the question is read the question well. Understand what is exactly being asked. Examples I'm giving here is management of a case of BRVO versus treatment of BRVO. So there's a little bit, there is a subtle difference where management really includes many more things, but treatment is only the treatment. Clinical features of AMD versus clinical trials in AMD. In your hurry, you may just think about clinical features of AMD, but actually the question may be clinical trials in AMD. The word is clinical here, but the thing that follows it is entirely different. So understand what is exactly being asked first. And third is, plan your answer before starting. So there are, in DNB, there are 10 short structured questions in each theory paper. And the very important word here is structured. You are expected to attempt each question in about 15 to maximum of 18 minutes. So it's always good, to carefully plan and enumerate on the first page of your answer sheet. Whenever you're beginning, it's always good to, write in bullets, okay, this is what I'm going to write. What would be the key points and how will you illustrate your points in flow diagrams, etc. It's you know, it's good to read this journal called Survey of Ophthalmology. I don't know whether you've heard about this journal. So it publishes something called Major Reviews. It is the most comprehensive work on any particular chapter or on any particular disease. So you can look at the headings which are there in you know, the major review and how it is written. So it's a good idea to, you know, structure your answers like that. American Academy of Ophthalmology publishes something called Preferred Practice Patterns, which are again very freely available. It also has a very beautiful plan of, you know, in the way the material is presented. You can take a look at those. So for example, you know, if there is a case of a management of CRVO, you jot down the points, say introduction, clinical features, ancillary testing, systemic workup, treatment options, and results of, say, important clinical trials that influence decision making. Imagine yourself being an examiner, or you're actually, you know, looking at the answer sheet, you will immediately be impressed. You know, the student is going to write a little bit about each of these. So it really strikes a chord. So, you know, they are already prepared and they're looking forward to your answer. And imagine looking at question 2, question 3, question 5, question 7. So you are continuously impressing the examiner. The chances of you getting higher marks every subsequent question also really increases. So what this plan really does, it makes a great impression, first up, like I said, you know, shows that you are very thorough in your thought process. You yourself don't forget to write the essentials, because, you know, sometimes you may really forget a little bit of that you thought you should write about clinical trials, but you really forgot that. So you will not forget yourselves, and helps to focus your mind on that answer much better, believe me. So when you write these down and then execute that, your answer will be much more impressive. Then plan your answer before starting. So like I said, practice planning for questions. By referring to the sample questions, you can develop a plan even when you're preparing. You should have a diary. So I'm repeating this again. I have maintained a diary throughout my residency. And you should discuss this plan with your colleagues. Then it comes to, you know, it's one to write the plan, but it's another thing to actually execute it. So don't write excessively long sentences. Use appropriate headings. Highlight keywords in your answer. Underline what you want the examiner to read. Use tables wherever possible. Minimize text. So instead of text, you know, it's helpful to present things in tables. Use as many flowcharts as possible. Say, for example, you know, mechanism of action of botulinum toxin. You know, so it's basically a stepwise way in which the toxin works. So it's always good to make a flowchart to show how the things happen. And tabulate clinical trials as best possible. Again, I'm saying look at American Academy of Ophthalmology preferred practice patterns. You will get a very good idea of how to present clinical trials in a tabular fashion. So concentrate on better presentation and easy readability. And so use bullets, flow diagrams, boxes, squares, etc. for highlighting key issues that actually draws attention. Logical organization of the contents is the key of the key issues. Avoid writing controversial points. One or two issues in each paragraph. References if possible. You know, there are some students who actually give references in their answers. Says you've read something in Survey of Ophthalmology about management of CRVO, and it's written by Dr. Sohan Singh Hare, who's very famous. You can actually cite that paper. It makes a great impression. So for example, we look at executing your answer. So management of CRVO, again, the same example. So introduction, clinical features, you know, tables for ischemic versus non-ischemic. So a quick tabular column will tell them that you know the clinical features. Ancillary testing, say fundus photo, fluorescein angiography, OCT, OCTA. You can actually draw label diagrams for the OCT instead of actually just writing everything. Systemic workup, you can quickly enumerate. Treatment options, enlist again in a tabular column. And results of clinical trials that influence decision making in this disease, namely CVOS and the CRUS recommendations, at least should always be part of your answer. And again, looking at some nitty-gritties of executing your answer, there should be, you know, margins, upper, lower, right, and left. Write the question number and the question again. That also actually focuses your mind a lot on that. Letter size and shape, you know, think about it shouldn't be too small to read, too large to read. And spacing between words, underlying important, you know, key parts, and carry color pencils, use them judiciously. Coming to handwriting, you know, many a times some of us may not have good handwriting to convey to the examiner effectively. So practice writing quickly but legibly. Practice really makes it you much better. It's a concept, you know, that writing more will fetch you more marks. Write more, but that's probably not true. And the examiner really looks for key points. You know, that's pretty much everything, everywhere. This is, you know, Google works on keywords. PubMed search works on keywords. Similarly, people are really looking at keywords. Have you mentioned these 10, 12 keywords in your answer? And lastly, time management. attempt questions in order of appearance if possible. So there is a reason why question one is question one and not question 10. Avoid the urge to attempt the question that you know well first. It's very easy to say, oh, this question five, that's my favorite. Let me write that first. So you might actually keep writing a lot and waste a lot of time on that. If you're skipping a question, at least write the answer plan on the first page that we've already discussed before you skip it. Attempt all questions without fail. That is a no-brainer. You have to write something for each answer. Practice writing answers before exams and time it if you can. Have an eye out on the watch to avoid overshooting even a single question. I think that's very important. So take-home messages is basically plan for writing when preparing itself. Write your plan before starting the answer. Use bullets, headings, flow diagrams, and tables. Reduce written text. Underline key points to highlight them. Handwriting fast but legible, and time management is extremely essential. Thank you.
I think those are very key points that sir has addressed over here. Harsha sir, would you like to add some points to this?
I am attending this sort of session maybe since 30 years, but along with the time, the new generation people, their message they are giving, their clarity of thought is very much amazing to me. So I have nothing to add. You have covered all the points, and I think with that a good mark or simply passing the examination is not a difficult job. But the way that you have given the message is fantastic.
Thank you, sir. I'd like to thank the I'd like to thank everybody for the session that they've come over here. I'd also like to thank the people chairing and moderating the session. Now I'll give over the mic to Apurva to hand the awards for the York session and the oculoplasty session. After the awards, then we'll start with our second session.
Pleasure to announce the winners of the Young Ophthalmologist Retina Case Competition. I would like to thank all the presenters for, first of all, presenting such great cases and having submitted their cases on such short notice, I should say. We had an outpouring of responses. I'm deeply grateful to all of you for supporting this maiden venture. There were about 21 cases that were presented, and we are proud to say that the session went on for almost 4 hours, and it was very well attended, and we had very good judges to judge them. The cases were judged on the basis of the quality of the case, the presentation skills of the speaker, as well as how well they answered the questions posed by the judges. So I hope there are no hard feelings. All the cases were good, and for me, everybody won. For everybody won, but since the competition was quite fierce, I should say, there are only a few winners, but no hard feelings, I hope. So I would like to call Dr. Ronil for distributing the participation certificates. Dr. Chintan Desai. Dr. Kushagra Jain, if he's here. Dr. Sriram Simakurti. Dr. Balraj. Dr. Sugaranjini. No problem. Dr. Uday Tekchandani. Dr. Ashish Mitra. Dr. Neha Adlaka, Dr. Anurag Mittal, Dr. Asha Purna, Dr. Ajinkya Deshmukh. Dr. Anmol Nayak, Dr. Dhayavat Shah, Dr. Rituja Thomas, Dr. Prateek Nishant, Dr. Savitri, Dr. Priyanka Gupta, Dr. Payal Shah. Now is the time to announce the winners. So first I would like to announce the winners of the rapid fire case presentation category. The second prize goes to Dr. Balraj, who presented a very rare case of bilateral choroidal osteoma with multifocality. And the first prize I would like to announce Dr. Chintan Desai. I would like to invite Dr. Harsha Bhattacharji for giving away the prizes for the medical cases. The third prize goes to Dr. Sugaranjini. Okay. The second prize goes to Dr. Uday Tekchandani, who presented a very nice case of dual virus positivity in a case of progressive outer retinal necrosis. And the first prize goes to the obvious winner, I think, Lieutenant Colonel Pradeep Kumar, for presenting a rare case of fungal endogenous endophthalmitis. Lastly, the surgical case competition. The third prize goes to Dr. Kushagra Jain. The second prize goes to Dr. Shriram Simkurti. And the first prize goes to Dr. Puneet Islur for presenting a rare case of surgical situation in a macular dystrophy. I request Dr. Guru Prasad also to come and give the surgical prize away. Thank you so much to all the participants again, and thank you, sir, for coming and giving away the prizes. And congratulations to all the winners.